Cobain was not only weary of the hype surrounding his groundbreaking band, he was also suffering from chronic stomach ailments, depression, and a heroin habit.
His stomach pain was clearly connected to the times of his greatest drug abuse. He began to use opiates, basically as a way to self-medicate his problems that he couldn't get an answer to otherwise.
It isn't a specific stomach ailment. It doesn't have a name or anything. I mean, it'd been building up for so many years that I was, you know, suicidal. I mean, I just didn't want to live. So I just thought, if I'm gonna die, if I'm gonna kill myself, I should take some drugs, you know? May as well become a junkie, because I felt like a junkie every day.
He mentioned suicide in virtually every interview he did in some way or another. But at the time, we weren't looking at it and thinking, this is somebody who is struggling. We looked at it as somebody who was very cynical about life at times and tossed those words off, just like other people talked about ordering a sandwich.
On March 2nd, after months on the road, Cobain was diagnosed with severe laryngitis and bronchitis and told to rest. Nirvana canceled the last two shows on their European tour.
His stomach pain was serious. It literally was to the point of vomiting up bile and blood on the floor before the show, clutching his stomach.
Kurt flew to Rome and waited for his wife, Courtney Love, and baby daughter, Frances Bean, to join him the next day.
Kurt hadn't seen Courtney for 27 days. They had a happy reunion. He had bought her gifts, but he was struggling clearly at that point already. He was really suffering depression.
On the night of March 3rd, Courtney went to bed. Kurt didn't. According to published reports, Kurt drank champagne and swallowed 50 to 60 tablets of a powerful tranquilizer called Rohypnol. The next morning, Courtney found Kurt unconscious and rushed him to the hospital.
We were all concerned that he was going to die.
We prayed for Kurt and hoped for the best.
As Kurt lay in a day-long coma, Nirvana's management told the press that he had accidentally overdosed.
These were pills that had to be individually unwrapped, so this was not accidental. They had to be popped out of a blister pack.
Within days, Kurt was well enough to travel. But back home in Seattle, Kurt wasn't any healthier or happier. On April 5th, 1994, 1 month after his apparent suicide attempt in Rome, Kurt Cobain ended his pain.
He walks out to his greenhouse. He takes a dose of heroin, which itself probably would have been fatal. And he shoots himself with a shotgun. His body isn't discovered till 3 days later.
In the early morning hours of April 8th, an electrician working at Cobain's house stumbled upon Kurt's lifeless body. He notified a colleague who called Seattle radio DJ Marty Reamer.
One of the request lines ring. We answer it, and it's a guy who says, "You're going to owe me some Pink Floyd tickets for this bit of news." And he said, very bluntly, "Kurt Cobain just shot himself with a shotgun."
After confirming the story with the Seattle police, Reamer went on the air and broke the news to the world.
The phone lines lit up instantaneously. The receptionist comes running in going, "What do I tell these people?"
Seattle was swarmed upon by media. MTV had cameras over here within 5 hours of Kurt's body being discovered.
2 days after Kurt's suicide was revealed to the world, the city of Seattle staged a public memorial in front of the city's landmark, the Space Needle.
Being in Seattle at the time, where, you know, I'm talking to record store people and fans on the street, it was the equivalent of when, you know, Elvis died or John Lennon.
In a taped statement to thousands of her husband's grieving fans, Courtney Love read part of Kurt's farewell note, then condemned his suicide as a senseless act.
I still can't get out the frustration, the guilt, and the empathy I have for everybody. There's good in all of us, and I simply love people too much. So why didn't you just stay? So much that it makes me feel too sad. The sad, little, sensitive, unappreciative Pisces Jesus man. Oh, shut up, pastor.
I think it was great that she did that, because it sort of turned, you know, it tore down him as a martyr. You know, he was an ass for doing it, not a martyr. He didn't die for rock and roll.
Kurt's death
from a community point of view, just seemed to take the wind out of everybody's sails.
Kurt's death was a shroud over the rest of that year. It didn't matter what happened. We could have landed on Mars, and it would have been, you know, somehow less sweet.
Kurt said to me, really, the only covers I really care about is I want to be on the cover of People magazine. He said, really ironically and sadly, he was on the cover of People magazine. It was after he died.
In the wake of his suicide in April of 94, Kurt Cobain became an even greater celebrity in death than he'd been in life. The media circus surrounding his death put his widow in the spotlight.
And the sky was made of amethyst.
Within a week of her husband's suicide, Courtney Love and her band Hole released their major label debut.
And I'm the one with no soul.
The title, you know, Live Through This, it was almost as if it was planned, but obviously it wasn't.
It's just unbelievably, tragically ironic. But maybe she did live through this. She went through this, you know, horrible nightmare, and she survived it.
She also became famous. Whatever the merits of Hole's music, Courtney Love became best known as alternative rock's most celebrated widow.
It was unfortunate timing, really, because Live Through This is a really good record.
Then, 2 months after Cobain's death, the media focused its cameras on another celebrity tragedy, as Kurt and Courtney gave way to OJ and Nicole.
Today, my office filed murder charges against OJ Simpson for the deaths of Nicole Brown Simpson and Ronald Lyle Goldberg.
If you can't take the heat, get your ass out the kitchen. We on a mission.
In the end, 1994 was a year where the sweet sounds of pop and hip-hop staged a full frontal assault on the music-loving masses, starting a trend that would continue through the millennium.
We passed upon the stand.
But while the alternative music movement of the early 90s may have lasted only a few short years, its impact and spirit won't be forgotten anytime soon.
20, 30 years from now, we won't be remembering Ace of Base or Mariah Carey. We'll remember Kurt Cobain's songs. We'll remember Eddie Vedder. We'll remember the artists that took big personal chances in their work, not the artists that were created by producers, not the people who looked great in the video. That's not going to be the music that we're going to look to 30, 40 years from now when we remember the 90s.
I still hear it. When's the next Nirvana going to hit? When's the next Nirvana? We desperately need a new Nirvana. The new Nirvana will not sound like Nirvana, that I know. There'll be something very real about it. I think it's going to happen sooner than later. And, you know, we desperately need it.